Pierre Picard was a 19th century shoemaker who lived in Nîmes, France. He had a small shop and had established himself as a competent cobbler and shoe craftsman. In 1807, Pierre had found his dream woman. Not only was she beautiful, but she was rich. He couldn't quite believe the fates could be so kind to him. Pierre had three friends, Lopion, Solari, and Chabard, who instead of being overjoyed for their comrade, were very jealous of his good fortune. In fact, one of them, Lopion, had longings for Pierre's intended bride. They decided to play a cruel joke by informing the government that Pierre was a spy for England. He was taken away and interrogated as a traitor. Pierre had a fourth friend called Alud, who, although not involved in the conspiracy, did not inform Pierre or tell the authorities the truth about Pierre's innocence. And so Pierre Picard was duly convicted and sentenced to 7 years in the fortress Fenestrelle in northern Italy. It wasn't until his second year there that he found out how his friends had ruined him. During his confinement, he started conversing with a prisoner in the adjoining cell who was a wealthy priest by the name of Father Torri. Pierre slowly but surely burrowed a tunnel between the two cells, which enabled the two friends to finally meet. Pierre confided to Father Torri about the conniving of his former friends, and the priest felt great compassion for his new friend. About a year after this, Father Torri lay on his deathbed in the cell. As Father Torri lay dying, he gave Pierre a map pinpointing where he had hidden a great treasure in the grounds of his church in Milan. He bequeathed this treasure to Pierre. He had also imparted great knowledge and taught Pierre how to conduct himself in fashionable society. Enduring this living death, Pierre became weakened, bitter and delusional. But one thing kept him going, the love for his fiancée. He was sure she would still be waiting for him once he was released. Pierre was released in 1814 after the fall of the imperial government. he journeyed immediately to Milan to unearth the treasure that Father Torre had buried. With his newfound wealth, Pierre returned to Paris to discover that 2 years after he had been imprisoned, his fiancée had married his former friend Lupion. Pierre spent the next years in isolation, plotting his revenge upon those he had once called friends. He devised a plan to bring the utmost misery to his enemies, so they could realize who was behind their ruin before they met their fate at his hands. Pierre first murdered Chobar, or possibly had him murdered. Pierre then tricked Lupion's daughter into marrying a criminal, whom he later had arrested. Lupion's daughter died of shock shortly thereafter. Picard then burned down Lupion's restaurant, destroying all he had lived for. This left Lupion impoverished and on the verge of collapse. Next, he exacted his revenge upon Solari by administering poison to him by adding it to his evening meal. Solari died in agony the next day. Pierre then put the final part of his plan to destroy Lupion into action. He manipulated Lupion's son into stealing some gold jewelry and then framed him for it. When the lad was sent to jail, Pierre finally stabbed his foe Lupion to death. The fourth former friend, Alut, who although not directly involved in the ruination of Pierre Picard, felt he would be next on Pierre's list. With this in mind, he turned the tables and kidnapped the unsuspecting Pierre. Before Alut put an end to Pierre Picard's life, Pierre let him know of all that had transpired since being imprisoned. Alut then killed Pierre, ending the shoemaker's trail of destruction. This true story from the French police records showed that Picard not only sought revenge against those who falsely accused him, but also ruthlessly against their family members. Alut's deathbed confession forms the bulk of the police records of this case. Alexandre Dumas read of this case and was inspired to base his 1844 novel, The Count of Monte Cristo, on it. The end. Stay tuned, my friends, for an Oddie Blah Blah. Well, my friends, I hope you enjoyed this re-edit of a previously silent historical feature with a few extra visual additions for your enjoyment. Yes, before I forget, do you remember the poll I had about my avatar, whether we should keep it or get rid of it? And as you can see, I had forgot all about to give you the results, and here they are now. You can see that 84% are in favor of keeping it, against 15% who would like to change it. So it would appear that the vote is overwhelming in favor of keeping it. So if you're happy, I'm happy with that too. Fantastic. Regarding the last video, the disappearance of Orion Williamson, also a re-edit with narration, I asked you at the end whether any of you had experienced any paranormal activity in your life, and the response was overwhelming. I was really quite amazed that so many people wrote in to tell of their experiences. I hadn't expected so many, really. Quite fascinating. Some of them are very touching, others are very eerie, creepy. I read them all. And it just goes to show how many people have experienced that can't be explained. I think there has to be something to it. People can usually tell the difference between a daydream or a dream or imagination. People can usually tell when something is not of the physical world, where it's beyond rational explanation. I'm still mulling over whether I could actually do a sort of compilation of the readers, of the viewers' stories. What would make it even more interesting would be if any of you had any photos or images to accompany the story. I think that would really add something to the video. If any of you had any photos to go with it, of the house, if there was a house involved, or if it was a person, a deceased relative, or whatever, any sort of photographs, images that you could send me, I think that would make the features quite interesting, and I will be thinking about doing that. I wonder what you think. I know that you have committed your experience to the internet. Would you be prepared to let me make a story about it? As I say, it's still in the thought stages. Regarding this video, have any of you plotted and actually exacted revenge upon anyone? I think that would be an interesting topic this week, and it would be only fair if I was to let you know a couple of my revenges that I exacted upon people in my life. Not many, but these were a couple that I do remember. One was when I was a child, and I'll get to that, and one as an adult. Also, I might actually start doing some videos of my experiences with the paranormal. The first one I might be doing was a house that we lived in when I was a child, which was really haunted, with poltergeist activity and apparitions, both witnessed by myself and my parents and people who came to stay at the house. So that will probably be my next story. I shall probably make the video as I've done the historical features in that type of format. I think it might be quite interesting, and it's true. It comes from Oddie's life. Here is my first revenge confession. When I was a child, for a few years we lived in the north of England, and I had a best friend there, and we were really quite mischievous children and got up to no good all the time, and we played tricks on each other, and sometimes it was quite vicious. Anyway, one evening we were coming home from another village. We had other friends there, and we were carrying on, punching each other on the bus, and he actually got off a stop before my stop. He wanted to go to the fish and chip shop. So he got off, and before the bus pulled away from the curb, he motioned to me to open the window. Those buses had the top part of the window, you could actually slide it down. So I did that, opened it, and he came up and he spat in my face. Full on, and the bus pulled away, and I was fuming, and he was laughing his head off, and I thought, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to beat the living beep out of him. So I got off at the next stop, and my intentions were that I would actually go to where he lived and hide in the bush, and when he came along the street, I would give him a right old beating. And then as I'm sitting there in the bush, revenge thoughts come into my mind, and I thought, I could do one better, actually, than punching him, you know. And it's quite a ghastly deed, my viewers. I actually spotted a dog's poo on the lawn. And yes, I am afraid to say, and I'm ashamed to say, but I was just a child, you know. Yes, I got a stick and I smeared the dog's poo on his door handle. Hit it quite well, and then waited there gleefully. And I spotted him coming along the street with his bag of fish and chips, looking quite pleased with himself that he'd got one over on me. And I just watched, and he came and put his hand on the door handle. It wasn't a doorknob, it was a handle. And then that look of horror and disgust on his face. And I must say it was very satisfying, because then it was my turn to laugh loudly and him to fly into a rage. So, yeah, that was my story of revenge as a child. My second act of revenge was not an injustice against me, but rather against somebody else where I worked. And this was quite some years back. I won't mention any names because the company still exists, but I don't know whether the people involved are still there. I doubt it. Where I worked, there was a young man there, and his name was Carl. That was actually his name. I won't mention his last name, of course. And there was a lady, and she was the manager. She was quite high up, right, very close to the owner, and she was a real tyrant, this woman. She was a battleship on legs. No one liked her. She was a real nasty piece of work. That's all I can say about her. I can't think of anything good to say. But this Carl was very close to her. He was always by her side. And, we found that somewhat suspicious. And there was an English guy there, and he was the supervisor. And he was a very affable guy. You know, he was very, very easy to get on well with. I immediately took a liking to him. He was, everyone liked him. And he was the supervisor, as I said. And he told us that this Carl was spying on us because, you know, the battleship on legs didn't actually come into our work area. You know, she was above that. But any incidents that happened, she would somehow find out about them. It was really annoying. And this supervisor said that this Carl, and by the way, he was deaf. He couldn't hear. I think he could hear some sounds. He lip read. And when he talked, he had that peculiar way of talking that deaf people have. This English guy said that this Carl was telling tales to her about things that we had done in our, you know, during our work time or during the pauses that we had, the lunch breaks. Everything went back to her. And this Carl, he never talked to anyone. He wouldn't speak to anyone. He didn't talk to us. So I believed what the supervisor was saying, and everyone did. And I was never nasty to this Carl. You know, I just avoided him. But others were openly nasty to him. I won't go into what they did and what they said to him, but it wasn't that nice. Anyway, after about 3 months of working there, and it was only a job. I wasn't planning on spending a long time there. Anyway, after 3 months, an old guy who was just about to retire, he came up to me after the lunch break one day, and he said quietly, could you just come over here? I'd like to tell you something. And I went over, and he said, you know how so-and-so, the supervisor, has been telling you that Carl goes and tells tales to the battleship on legs, actually, it's not Carl doing it. It's actually the supervisor. He's played you all for fools. He's been the whole time spying on you, and he's giving the information to the battleship on legs. And I was absolutely dumbfounded, quite shocked. I had judge the book by the cover. I had believed this guy because he was charming and friendly and humorous. And all this time, he was the one who was going telling tales and having the audacity to blame it on this poor guy. I was speechless. So that evening, as we were all packing up and going home, Carl was always the last to leave, always at his locker doing things, and everyone had gone, and I went up to him and I said, Carl, can I have a word? He looked around, quite surprised that someone was talking to him, not calling him names, and I said, I just found out that you are not the one who's telling tales to the battleship on legs, that it's the supervisor. And he said, yeah, he nodded in the affirmative. I could understand him. He did have that way of speaking that, as I say, that deaf people have. But I understood him perfectly. And he it was quite surprising because I'd never really talked to him before. He was really quite a pleasant guy. And I said to him, why didn't you tell us that it wasn't you? And he said, well, nobody would have believed me. You know, I don't have that charm that the other guys got. So I just let them believe what they wanted to believe. And I was really, you know, from that moment on, I became a really good friend. We became good friends. I found he had a lifelong interest in the Titanic. So, you know, I gave him some souvenirs that I had collected, newspaper clippings and stuff. And, you know, I saw him in a totally different light. And he appreciated that. You know, he shone from that day on. He knew that the truth was at least with me. And so my act of revenge was I made sure that everybody knew who the real culprit was. Yeah, I told everyone. And I also told his best friend, the supervisor's best friend. I knew he'd tell him. I wanted him to know that I knew. And that guy was, man, he was like a deflated balloon after that. You know, I was just disgusted with him. And I left. Not long after that, I actually had a raging argument with the battleship on legs and told her what I thought of her. The elderly secretary in the background was giving me the thumbs up, and afterwards she said nobody's ever spoke to her like that before. So I had my joy there. And afterwards that guy, he left, that supervisor, you know, he was finished there. And some months later I drove up there and Carl was there, and it was just good to see that Carl, had been vindicated, and it was good to see that he was happy now. The people knew, and they respected him, and that was my tale of revenge against someone who committed an injustice against someone else. So I would like to know your tales of revenge, whether it's a revenge, as I say, against yourself, or whether you've actually helped someone out and got revenge for them. Just one more point on lessons learned. In hindsight, the battleship on legs, I saw her in a different light too. You know, she actually took Carl under her wing. She could see that he was despised by everyone, and she was very strong in her favoring him, which probably didn't look good for him, but I think he had that support from her, and I admire her for that, actually. So I do have something good to say about her at the end. Anyway, I've blah-blahed on enough, so yeah, I would love to hear your tales. And please, guys, please thumb up, you know, make a comment and share the videos. That really, really helps, you know, me to get the views and gets me a bit of revenue and keeps me going, and that's really important. Thank you. Love you. See you next time. Bye-bye. Just one very last thing I nearly forgot. To my Patreon supporters, I have a new video up just in case you haven't logged into your account. So go check it out. And to people out there who aren't a Patreon supporter of me, you might like to consider it. It's as little as $1. You get to see this video and a couple of others that are not available on YouTube. And I will be making more for my Patreon supporters. This just helps me to keep going. And I really appreciate your support. And I try to make it worthwhile. I want my supporters to get something. And here we have the latest video. I think you'll enjoy it. Check it out. Thank you. Bye-bye.